A major breakthrough tonight in a cold case from more than a half century ago. Maybe the oldest case where DNA evidence led to an arrest.
Well, hello, and thank you for joining us, everyone. You're listening to The Crime Room, a true crime podcast about how homicide detectives catch bad guys. On today's show, we have somebody who is really twisted. We're going to talk about a serial killer that is fascinating. But before we jump right in, I'm your co-host, Jolene Grace, and my co-host is Branden.
Hi, everyone. How are we doing today?
He is not only my husband, but he is also the expert on our show. He has over 10 years of experience in the police field, and I am looking forward to asking all the dark, gruesome questions that I have been storing in my mind. So we're gonna find out how detectives investigate, collect evidence, how they catch bad guys, and how they prove that the bad guys really did it. Thank you for agreeing to do the show with me.
Well, thank you for that wonderful introduction. And you have quite the rap sheet yourself.
Guilty as charged.
Jolene, she's a crime junkie at heart. Ever since I met her, she loves reading, writing, and watching true crime-related material. Mm-hmm. And because of her over 10 years' experience as a journalist, mm-hmm. while even interning at CBS News, mm-hmm. she is able to deep dive into these cases and really shed some light and ask me some pretty difficult questions. She also writes crime fiction full-time, and she blogs for thecrimeroom.com.
Yeah, if you haven't been to our website, thecrimeroom.com, please do so. Follow us on social media, come hang out with us, and find out what we're all about. And now with the introductions out of the way,
let's talk crime.
No, that's right. Let's talk crime. Richard Cottingham, a.k.a. the Torso Killer, a.k.a. the Times Square Killer, was incredibly sadistic, perverted, and twisted. Not only did he rape his victims, beat them to death, strangle them, but he also mutilated them.
Right.
Recently, he gave an interview where he admits or makes the claim that he's killed anywhere between 80 to 100 women. Now, I'm not sure if I really believe that number, because serial killers are famous for exaggerating.
Right.
But if that number is even remotely close, I mean, even 50 victims, that is a lot.
That is a lot. A lot of unidentified Jane Does out there, families missing them and mm-hmm. looking mm-hmm. for them, or bodies that have already been discovered that they can't connect to the torso killer. Mm-hmm. He stated that he's not sure, so killing somebody is a pretty serious incident, and the fact that you don't know how many people you've killed just seems a little off to me. I feel as though if these numbers were accurate, he would know the number.
You think he might be exaggerating, or he's just playing mysterious?
I think he knows the number, mm-hmm. which I think is more than 13 or 12, which mm-hmm. is the official number of
what
of victims he's been charged with and mm-hmm. or confessed to that they can corroborate to actual evidence. I think he has a number that's greater than that. However, I think he took his number and just threw out a range greater to make himself look more prolific so that he becomes more infamous and known to the world.
Mm-hmm. So before we go in further into discussing the torso killer, let's back up a little bit. He has a label. He's classified as most things in this world. As a society, we like to label things because it helps us keep things organized. And he is labeled as a sadist.
Right.
Tell us more about that.
Right. So someone who is a sadist, they focus on the suffering of the victim. And that suffering actually arouses them.
Brings them pleasure.
Sexually arouses them. So mm-hmm. it brings them more pleasure. So while either raping the victims, he may employ other tactics or other suffering, such as biting, pulling, hitting, beating, and of course strangling in his case, which was almost every one of his victims, to further gratify his needs. And that is why he truly became, or is labeled, a sadist.
And now his victims, they really were wide range of ages, demographics.
Right, from the known cases, 13 to 29. And
that's a wide range.
Right, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, not every victim had the same way of operating. Not all, some were sex workers, some were abducted while walking to a mall or hitchhiking. So he didn't really focus on one type of MO. It appears that he was off hinge and he would kind of go on impulse.
Mm-hmm. Something will trigger him, and to release that stress or whatever was going on in his life, he will snatch somebody off the street and whatnot. So what you're saying is the kills, the rapes, the mutilations, there were chances somebody had the misfortune to cross his path when he had a bad day.
Yeah, so it appears that the victims didn't have a proper guardianship. And what I mean is they didn't have somebody looking after them.
Mm-hmm.
Either they were a sex worker who were out doing their own thing, or they were a teenager who were alone and didn't have a parent or an adult with them to protect them from being abducted.
There's also another reason why we chose the torso killer to be our first serial killer that we discuss on the show. Recently, his murders were brought back to life in the media because one of the oldest DNA to be tested in the country was connected to him.
That's right. In 1968, Diane Cusick was found murdered in her car in the parking lot of the Green Acres Mall. Now, back then, there was a drive-in movie theater in this area. And that is what recently led Suffolk police to tipping off Nassau County police that someone currently in jail in New Jersey may have committed a crime near that drive-in movie. And that narrowed it down and led to a DNA match.
Right, and that's crazy to think.
50-year-old DNA.
Yeah, 50 years, back before they knew what DNA testing was and how to properly collect evidence and prepare for it. They were grabbing this stuff so that one day they can hopefully connect it to a murderer or somebody involved in it so that they can charge or gain some closure for the family.
So he started killing somewhere around 1967?
Yes, he was 21 years old when he made his first kill, and it started at 1967.
It's interesting to point out that before that he didn't have a record. He wasn't in the system. He was actually born and raised in a stable family home. He had a mom, a dad, probably a dog. He lived in suburbia. Sounds like his parents had a very traditional roles. Mom stay home, dad goes to work. He had siblings as well.
Yeah, three sisters, younger sisters. He was the oldest of the four.
Mm-hmm.
And it's crazy to think that him as the oldest, where you would typically see him taking the protector role of his sisters, would then turn around and become this serial killer to other women and a mass amount of women and really not have the
sympathy.
Empathy. To
no show of empathy or remorse for his crime. And some of the interviews, when you watch him, it's like he discusses his murders as like, what did I eat for lunch the other
day? Casual, just talking about it like nothing
crazy
happened.
Yeah, there's no emotion there.
Right.
But with other serial killers, there were signs along the way in childhood and being a teenager and becoming a young man. It seems like either his parents really kept him out of trouble, or something happened in that he turned 20, he became independent, he left mom and dad home, and he was like, okay, now I'm ready to live my true self. I'm ready to let that monster out and unleash that hatred that I've been living with.
Yes, that goes back to the argument of nature versus nurture.
That's right.
Right. So what you're referring to is the nurture part, mm-hmm. which is essentially stating that everything appeared normal when he was growing up, that mm-hmm. he should have acted normal, normal in society. Mm-hmm. And that would move more towards the nature case, saying that he had something wrong with his brain from birth, stating that he was going to be a serial killer when he was born. And like you said, he really didn't get to unleash or mm-hmm. act upon until he was by himself and able to do the things he wanted to do. In the natural case, of course, is referring to the lack of empathy, which is the lack of understanding others' emotions and others' pain. Mm-hmm. And a lack of apathy, which is not caring about the world, not caring about anything, just going on about life in their own way. However, the nurture case still could be considered because there's a lot of his life that is unknown. There's a lot of events that could have happened that we're not privy to because we were never there or we don't have a witness. So maybe something could have happened to his sisters that he witnessed. Or he could have been abused or neglected.
And or he could have abused his sisters and mom and dad never reported it.
Right, absolutely. That's a great example. Mm-hmm. Stuff that go unreported all the time because they believe that they were the perfect family. They didn't want the world to know their problems. Mm-hmm. And they kept it underreported so that nobody would know.
So Richard Cottingham, the torso killer, was born November 25th, 1946 in Bronx, New York City, and his family later on moved to New Jersey. Why is this important? I think he killed primary in New Jersey, in New York. So he stayed in the two primary areas
right.
that he knew. He knew very well. Mm-hmm. He knew practically every street, the ins and outs. So pretty much he was hunting in his backyard.
Right, and all the official cases that have been connected to him were those two states. Mm-hmm. So he's claiming to have done, going back to his claim, mm-hmm. 80 to 100 victims. It's hard to perceive that all those victims were in those two states, unless, of course, he went to a different state. Because I feel as though the MOs would be the same or similar, that they would be able to now, after knowing who he was, connect them to him mm-hmm. at a higher rate, mm-hmm. as opposed to if 13% rate if the 100 victims was true.
All right, so after graduation, he graduates high school. He has no formal college education that we know.
Right.
He goes to work for his dad or with his dad.
Yep.
Dad gets him a job at the company he works, and Richard Cottingham starts at the mailroom.
Yep, right at the bottom floor. Mm-hmm.
So it takes him a few years, and in 1966, he becomes a computer operator for Blue Cross Blue Shields.
Right. And there's an interesting fact about that. When he was working at Blue Cross Blue Shield, he was actually working alongside another serial killer, Rodney Alcala, who is also known as the dating game killer. And journalists have spoken to both of them. And the crazy thing is neither of them knew the other person was a serial killer or knew that they could have been a serial killer.
Now let's pause and think about this. We have two serial killers who share common space. They probably rode on the same elevator. They probably rubbed shoulders at, you know, the entrance.
Right.
You know, they probably maybe even sat by the water bubbler. Imagine the conversation they would have if they both knew that they were serial killers.
Right. And that's a new level of water bubbler talk that hopefully we don't have to deal with. Mm-hmm. But that's another interesting case that what if they did find out? Would they have worked together? Or do you believe that they would kind of want to be the alpha and do their own thing and become more infamous than the other one? or even try to kill the other one so that they don't give him up. So I believe that because of Cottingham's impulse behaviors, he was unable to control himself. I don't believe he would have worked well with others. It was more of an opportunity. So it's not like they would drive around together at all times and then find somebody. The dating game killer was much more precise and able to plan out his attacks. So I don't think they would have worked out together either.
But in the end of the day, I think the
dating game killer?
The dating game killer, thank you, got caught first before the torso killer.
Right, so I guess it wouldn't have worked in his benefit.
Yes, being organized is not always the right way to go.
And you would think with his lack of empathy and apathy, you know, he wouldn't be in the dating game himself.
Mm-hmm.
But he did. He found somebody, a Janet Cottingham, and he married her May 3rd, 1970.
The torso killer.
The torso killer did, yes. And they had three children together, two boys and a girl.
Yeah, so it's interesting that he was able to marry and have children, because during the time of his marriage and even before he met her and married her, he had already begun to kill and rape.
Right. And he was still doing it while he was married to her.
Yeah.
As well as while their children were being born.
That's right.
And it's awful to think the type of relationship they probably had together.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows in what happened, because the Janet eventually filed for divorce in 1978.
She makes some pretty scary claims in her divorce petition about him. Lack, again, of empathy, show of emotions. He is verbally abusive to her and the kids. He is withholding love and affection. He is not providing financial support for her and the children.
Yeah, it sounds like she wanted more of a traditional role,
mm-hmm.
where she would take care of the kids and mm-hmm. he would make the money and mm-hmm. they would raise a household together.
Yeah.
However, he just went off on his own, stopped giving her any sorts of money or financial aid, and was staying out too early in the morning.
And now she hung on to that marriage for quite a while, because during their marriage, he had been arrested and he became to have a rap sheet.
Right. While they were still married. Mm-hmm. And there were some crazy crimes that were in there too, that would indicate that something wasn't right. So to get into that, if you go under his rap sheet, in 1969, October 3rd, he was charged and convicted of drinking and driving in New York City and sentenced to a $50 fine. 3 years later, after they've been married, August 21st, 1972, he was charged with shoplifting from a Stearns department store. Are you familiar with Stearns? I don't know anything about Stearns.
No, we don't shop there.
Yeah. That was in New Jersey, and he also paid a $50 fine as opposed to a 10-day sentence in jail. But here, there are two further crimes that he was allegedly committed that showed the problems with the marriage as well. September 4th, 1973, a sex worker claimed that Cottingham was her pimp, had robbed, sodomized, and sexually abused her. Cottingham was arrested in New York for the charges, but the case was later dismissed as neither party appeared in court. And let's get to the 1 year later, March 12th, 1974. A different sex worker claimed that Cottingham unlawfully imprisoned her, and again, both parties did not show up for court. And it's interesting to think of what would have happened if those victims went forward with being witnesses in the crime.
So let's slow down here. I have a couple of questions when it comes to sex workers. You've dealt with a lot of cases.
Right.
That involve sex workers. They usually are not the most reliable witnesses. They're not usually the most cooperative to deal with.
They have a lot of requirements to get them to actually testify in court. One of those reasons is that even though many states prohibit the defense to bring up their sexual history and whatnot. Not all do. So some states still allow the defense to say, hey, she's a prostitute. She sleeps around. You know, she shouldn't be trusted. That's one fear. Unfortunately, many of them are addicted to drugs and or alcohol, and they need to continue the lifestyle that they've been living in order to get those, fulfill their needs, as well as other cases of having children that they need to take care mm-hmm. of. But that's, in my experience, a lesser number.
So in your experience, do you feel as though the court dismisses sex workers' cases faster than, say, anybody else?
I wouldn't say faster, but more frequently.
More frequently.
Just because they're not willing. And that could be also that the pimp or the person that they're taking the charges against mm-hmm. threatens them mm-hmm. or actually abuses them. Mm-hmm. And if they're threatened or abused, they don't believe in the justice system, so they won't report those to us because they're like, hey, it didn't work the first time. I'm still being abused. I'm still being threatened. I have a life I want to live. I'm just going to stay away from the courts and the police altogether and just go on doing my thing.
Snitches get stitches.
As they say in the streets.
So in the case of the torso killer, I think he found a niche or a particular victim that was easy enough to lure, easy enough to manipulate. And if she vanished or disappeared, it's easy to say that she is unreliable. She ups up and leaves. You know, it's not uncommon for Jane Doe to just take off and be gone for days.
Right.
And so he stuck with it.
Right. Other than, of course, the young women who were abducted, mm-hmm. they had support systems in place and family mm-hmm. members who loved and cared for them. Mm-hmm. And the sex workers tend to have burned most of their bridges. And if they're gone for 2 weeks at a time, they've done that before. As you mentioned, they've mm-hmm. been gone. They just leave. They get high and they party for 5 days straight, or they're gone for a month and they come back begging for money. So when they are gone, what would be a alarming rate to somebody else?
Their families are used to it.
Yeah, their families are used to it. They're not going to report it right away.
Or they're fed up with it.
Yeah, and they're just...
lost cause.
Unfortunately, not going to do anything. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of backtracking. And with backtracking comes a lot of...
Tell us what backtracking is.
So basically, you have to try to live in the moment. So let's mm-hmm. say it happened 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. You need to try to live in the moment. You need to knock on doors to try to speak with witnesses, but many of them may forget if it's nothing crazy. Did mm-hmm. you see a car that day? Well, I don't know. It was 2 weeks ago. I don't remember what mm-hmm. I had for breakfast. Mm-hmm. But if you were there that day and you knocked on that door, but yeah, I saw the brown truck with the fender broken.
What is important that we should mention is a lot of the killings, the stranglings happened in city motels.
Oh, yeah. We'll get into all the details later, mm-hmm. but yes.
But a lot of the people that go to these motels are in and right. out. So now even you're left as an investigator with no witnesses or witnesses that will not cooperate.
Right. That's an excellent point.
City motels also don't keep good records. They prefer cash.
Purposely don't keep good records.
Right. So there's no tracing him, even in the methods that you're trained as a police officer.
Right. And usually, if you're there that day, something as heinous as this, mm-hmm. there will be people who, you know, hey, yeah, no, I did see a car. Or, you know, this guy, I've been here for a week, and this guy just showed up. Mm-hmm. But as you mentioned, they're leaving the next day. They're not going to...
Oh, even the next hour.
You're never going to find them. You'll mm-hmm. never get that information. That very important information that you would need to tie someone to this case or at least get on their tracks. Mm-hmm. Another issue is video surveillance.
In the 70s, I don't know how much video surveillance they even had back then.
Right, especially in a motel. Mm-hmm. I was thinking nowadays, that's an excellent point. Back in the 70s, if they had any, it was gone the next hour or day.
Mm-hmm. So you can't really make an argument against that the police didn't care or the society didn't care. It sounds like law enforcement had a lot of things going on against them, trying to track down and figure out who the torso killer is.
In this case, technology changed. Our witnesses finding an old police officer that remembered that original scene because they never erase in their mind what happened that day.
We absolutely want to work with all the victims because if we start getting rid of the pimps and the abusers, we will be able to help these sex workers move on in life and become functioning members of society. And if they were willing to work with us, we would be more than happy to fully process the scene and the incident to the fullest extent.
Now, a lot of DNA was usually collected from the crime scenes. DNA analysis wasn't up to where it is now.
Yeah, it wasn't the same.
Yet police officers bagged it, tagged it, and now, almost 50 years later, we have yet another victim that we can attach.
It wasn't until 2021, because of the advancements in DNA evidence, that we were able to retest some of the evidence that we had found in that 1968 murder. And when we retested it, we came up with a DNA sample. When we uploaded it to the National Databank, we got a hit telling us that it was Richard Cottingham.
Let's go back to his rap sheet. Because his last arrest was in 1974, and he was arrested in 1980. There's 6 years gap of God knows how many murders he's done in 6 years.
Especially if his claim of 80 to 100 is accurate. And actually 7 years, too, if you go back to 1973.
It's 1973, when a sex worker claims that the torso killer was her pimp, had robbed her, and sexually abused her.
Yep.
That case gets dismissed, even with these horrible charges, claims against him, because neither party shows up to court.
Well, first off, of course, many victims' lives would have been spared. Mm-hmm. But these are serious felony crimes. Mm-hmm. These are years imprisonment. So if he was charged and arrested for these crimes, he would have been in jail 7 years earlier. And within that 7 years, they would have been able to continue investigating those cold cases and hopefully connect him to the case. When we get into how he was arrested and apprehended, which was in 1980, it was a case of, we'll say, chance that may never have happened if he was arrested, but they could have spoken to him, maybe looked for a plea deal or something to get more information out of him while he was incarcerated.
And he gets arrested on May 22nd in 1980.
Yes.
In a New Jersey City motel.
Right. That is a crazy story, which we'll go into in episode 2.
That's right.
But that's a wild way to get arrested. It really shows how impulsive he was, because once we explain the facts, you'll see, yeah, why would he do that again?
Well, thanks for joining us. This was the first episode of The Crime Room, a true crime podcast about how homicide detectives catch bad guys. On the next episode, we will take a deeper look into some of the torso killer's victims and, of course, how he was apprehended and what was...